Our speaker tonight is Father Raymond Gawronski of the Society of Jesus. He entered the Maryland province of the Jesuits in 1977, was ordained a priest in 1986. In 1992, he took his doctorate in sacred theology at the Pontifical Gregorian University in Rome. He's a lifetime student of the work of Hans Urs von Balthasar. He's the author of Word and Silence, Hans Urs von Balthasar and the Spiritual Encounter Between East and West. He's written extensively on the subjects of dogmatic and mystical theology, as well as spirituality and various Slavic Polish topics as well. He's been a lecturer at Georgetown University for several years, professor of theology at Marquette. Finished a stint recently as a visiting professor at the Dominican School of Philosophy and Theology in Berkeley, and is commencing a post as professor at St. Patrick's Seminary in Menlo Park, California. He's going to address us this evening on St. John Paul II and the Polish Catholic Experience. Thank you, Father Gawronski.
Thank you for your welcome. Good evening. For those who speak Polish, it's Gawronski in Chicago, perhaps you could say that, but Gawronski in English. Although the title of our talk, John Paul II and the Polish Hermeneutic, certainly indicates the subject matter of the Polish Catholic Experience, the ambitious title that I really have for it is John Paul II and the Polish Hermeneutic. On one of two pilgrimages that I led to Poland from seminarians from Denver, at one point, one of the seminarians turned to me and he just said, there's a Polish hermeneutic. He was a very Anglo-seminarian from northern Colorado. But judging from the great popularity that John Paul enjoyed among the young, the whole generation of JP2 priests, I dare say there's a certain lens through which reality can be viewed, kind of an interpretive key, which is to be found in the Polish Catholic experience. And that is what I call the Polish hermeneutic. And it's that toward which we'll be moving in our investigation this evening, I hope. And so both for understanding John Paul, for a perception of the Polish experience, but also why would that be of interest? Well, it would be of somewhat certainly interest at a scholarly research center. But my interest is really more for the American church, or rather for the church in America. What does this experience say to us? Why did he elicit such profound depth of response from our young people, so many of them? A whole generation of priests refer to themselves as John Paul II priests. Why? And what was it from that experience that we might be able to relate to? I found something to the Polish nation which is unique. I've spent a lot of time there, and I've often remarked a quality that reminded me of the elves in Tolkien's writings, tall, fair, very gentle, and refined. There are Poles like that. Another Polish scholar said, no, Poles are really hobbits. And that may be as well, and certainly like to eat well. But there are people often with kind of Nordic coloring, but without that kind of a Germanic set of jaw that you experience with people further west. I asked my scholar friend about that, and she said, well, it's a hint of Catholic innocence. And I think that's interesting. What is it that has been in those faces? During one of John Paul's later visits to Poland, it was reported that 70% of the population went to confession within a few days of his visit. 70% went to confession. No matter how sinful the other 30% might have been, if nothing else, there's an awareness of sin that has got to make a difference, and there's much else. And by the way, yeah, I'm a professor and I have academic credentials, but I left the professorship to be a spiritual director. So bear in mind, I kind of work both sides of that street. And to speak of Polish Catholicism, and that naturally calls to mind people with a long history of being oppressed, and I would say truly oppressed, because at the outset, when I say truly oppressed, I mean people who have no access to the media, who are consistently represented by the media in particular. An underlining thesis of mine is that once you have access to the levers of power, especially in forming public opinion, you're no longer really oppressed, regardless of material poverty, which can be addressed much more easily than image, which tends to last. True oppression, I would say, means powerlessness. It means being lied about, having one's story either not told at all or perhaps worse, distorted. It means having your history told to your children by your enemies. It means being a victim of others, perhaps of others who cloak themselves in garments of victimhood. It's my contention that the Polish nation has been, in my terms, truly oppressed since at least the end of the 18th century, certainly in European discourse, that this oppression was in large part the fruit of the nation's identification with the Roman Catholic faith, and that this experience has molded a unique form of Catholicism, which is an incarnate model of what happens when one is faithful to God in this world, individually or corporately. But first, a disclaimer. I'm not a Polish citizen. As a matter of fact, I've tried three times, and even though my mother was in a concentration camp with the letter P, the Polish government will not give it to me. So you might contrast that with other European nations. Poles have a different approach to these things. My own Polishness may be somewhat suspect, though I was born in a place called Greenpoint, which is every bit as Polish as parts of Chicago. I say I'm a refugee from New York. My Polishness, again, is suspect on my mother's side because they're from the world of Czesław Miłosz, which isn't Polish anymore. And so when I go to visit my cousins, we speak Russian, very simply. They identify as Polish, but they speak Russian on that side. And so the Polishness I got on that side is really, if you know Czesław Miłosz and you know some of his writings, it's that world. And I call it kind of a fantasy world. The capital is Vilno. It's Litva, it's Mickiewicz, it's something you find in novels, but you're not going to find a whole lot of incarnate anywhere. I'm kind of one of the last representatives of such a world. And my father's people were much more typical Polish. However, even there, being Polish is very different. You'd have to, in the course of the talk, share some of it, ranging from practicing Catholics in a minority to ardent communists deported from this country for communist organizing, people who can be very pious, people who can be very moral, people who can be very immoral, and all points in between. I have a German Lutheran brother-in-law, two cousins married Polish Jews, and there's lots of Orthodox. My grandmother, I learned in Europe, was originally Russian but became Polish, which is to say she was Orthodox and became Catholic when she married my grandfather. So the whole question of what it is to be Polish, you know, is much broader than we tend to think. And part of it is you know, as a Catholic, you tend to deal with, okay, Ireland, Italy, Poland. Well, Ireland and Italy, it's clear what's Ireland. It's not Scotland, you know, and Italy is not Greece. Where is Poland at any given point? And my mother, who was from what is Belarusia today, never used the word Belarusia. She was always going back to Poland. I finally said to her, go to the Polish embassy and get a visa to go there. It doesn't exist. So, you know, 150-mile border shift makes a big difference. But my talk largely uses the experience of John Paul II as an entree, because it's dramatic, it's well-known, and it's edifying. His emergence from the church in Poland has to be looked at, how he then governed the universal church, and as a style of governance very much in line with his natural experience. And I think that yields an understanding to the Catholic response to systematic oppression. Well, you can imagine, if you know anything about the Polish experience, certainly for me, his election was the happiest day of my life, bar none. Even better than getting tenure. the keen sense of vindication and joy that I felt, and the phrase I kept hearing was exaltavit humiles, you know. And okay, it's kind of something burst open for the whole world. A few years later, in 1984, I was visiting Poland, staying at a modern communist hotel, which is a place where foreigners would come, and it was presumed you'd be engaging in prostitution and be blackmailed later. That's what these places were about, largely. But next door to this meretricious hotel, there was this little Catholic church in a town called Gdynia on the Baltic. And that's the first time I came across this saying from Faustina Kowalska, who wasn't a saint at the time, in fact, under suspicion in Rome. I've particularly fallen in love with Poland. These are the words of Jesus to her, the visionary. If Poland will remain faithful to me, I will lift her in honor. From her will come a spark that will prepare the world for my second coming, written in stone in a church. Well, in Poland, her message of mercy had helped the nation get through the Second World War, and once Wojtyła became pope, he right away began rehabilitating her and eventually canonizing her. Notice the message was mercy, not primarily justice. Mercy, not primarily justice, which is huge. For justice, we must go to Don Corleone, as you know. And I couldn't help but wonder if John Paul were not that spark, you know, that would ignite the world. There's kind of a Polish mystique around that. Well, there's no telling what lies ahead, but I don't suspect I'll ever see the likes of that day again. But before I came to have any sense of who he was, his name was so unknown to me, I thought he was an African. So many people did. The name wasn't obviously Polish to me. But there was a spirit of goodness there, great love of the church and of the mother of the church, the strength to both act and not to act. Before I had any idea at all what had happened, I rejoiced deliriously, at first as a Pole in America, but on reflection even more as a Catholic. Though he himself was very much a child of the Polish nation, one of the hallmarks of the pontificate of John Paul was the universal outreach of the office of Peter, breaking beyond the ancient Christian world into a truly global vision. He's always called the Polish Pope, you know. I mean, how many dozens of languages could he at least make himself understood in? I mean, Francis doesn't speak English, and no one calls him the Argentine Pope or something like that. It's something worth asking. Why was he the Polish Pope, and why was that such a big deal? Now, I will say his English was not quite perfect. I translated at World Youth Day in 1993 in Denver, and I was translating into German, and the German fellow and I were trying to translate for him, and we had no idea what he was saying when he landed, and we began saying, well, vielleicht das ist Navajo oder etwas, maybe he was speaking some American Indian language. We had no idea. Finally, they said, no, das ist English. So, so and his English got better over the years, though he did have one famous line from the Psalms when he says, I shoot with joy. You know? But, you know, but he was far more international than anyone thought, right? Interesting than any other pope. And I think that's part of being Polish. We tend to view Poland as the ultimate provincial backwater, right? I mean, that's really the image, but that just isn't the case. You think of poor Pope Benedict's Regensburg address. Well, a Muslim commentator wrote that John Paul was so friendly to Islam because there were longstanding Muslim communities with mosques in eastern Poland. And I knew that as a child. We had Muslim friends who were Tatars, spoke Belarusian, you know, from eastern Poland, and there were just Muslim communities that had been there for centuries. And Poland was a multi-confessional, multi-ethnic state, you know, for centuries. And so there was a kind of a cosmopolitanism, which is part of the experience, not just there can be a dreadful provincialism, but those things are often class. But certainly the elite or anyone educated prided themselves on this kind of cosmopolitanism. It must be noted at the outset that in his encyclicals he referred to the failed experience in Marxism, even as he showed himself profoundly concerned about the sinfulness and human misery that provoked those movements, and later he critiqued unbridled capitalism. So he was primarily a philosopher, I think, who stressed the universal validity of reason. Reason is extremely important for him, and the universal truths of the faith. Of course, Marxism claimed a universal validity, and its influence on Catholicism was strong in those poor countries whose theological elites looked to the West for social transformation. It's presumed that Poland, which was Catholic for 1,000 years, is only part of the general European religious conversation. But Poland has a history which in many ways has much more in common with the colonized and marginalized countries of the Third World than with the colonizing and empire-building traditions of the main European nations. You know, the pedagogy of the oppressed, I think, is helpful in looking at Poland. I think because of that history, Polish Catholics in Europe and America have had much more in common with the oppressed than with ruling elites in state or in church. I mean, the fact is, my mother was a slave laborer in Germany, and she was a slave. And she was a slave who was legally part of, was a subhuman. She was a subhuman by law. That's something you've got to look at. Something of that continues in the contempt Western Europe has shown for Polish plumbers. As a large European state, Poland was first divided up and then colonized by its neighbors. A republic of nobles with an elective monarchy was simply too far ahead of its time and place, it may well be, because the neighbors were heading into those ever stronger royal absolutisms which bred traditions of centralization, the consequences of which were reaped bitterly in the 20th century. The whole lens shifts, and I really don't want to be offensive, und ich spreche Deutsch, und очень люблю по-русски говорить, but the fact of the matter is, if you ask who the most famous German of the 20th century is, one figure comes to mind, the most famous Russian of the 20th century, somebody else comes to mind, and in Poland, it's John Paul II. You've got to look at that. Didn't just drop from the sky. And if you look at history, and you know, the history books that Americans tended to write, well, Poland couldn't govern itself, they weren't strong enough. Well, look at the people who could govern themselves and created empires the way we think you should create empires. There's something there for us to learn. Okay. And the accession of Wojtyła to the throne of St. Peter brought primarily, it seems, to the support of the German-speaking hierarchy, Cardinal Koenig of Vienna orchestrating it, was not a minor miracle, it was a major miracle. Not because he was a devotional man from a tradition-keeping church, that was true. The major miracle was that a pope from Poland should become pope. Remember, his father was an officer in the Austrian army, that his part of Poland was part of the Austrian Empire for 123 years of Poland's partitions, and maybe the primate of Austria had a lingering sense of attachment, and for their part, the Poles from Kraków at least speak of Babcia Austria, Grandma Austria, so there's some lingering sentiment in that part of the country for that. But if I may, I think another miracle is the close collaboration between Wojtyła and Ratzinger. I mean, you think of the centuries-long conflicts between different ethnies all over the world. In their lifetimes, that was a master-slave relationship, is between Ratzinger's people and Wojtyła's people. And it was in their lifetime they experienced that. And then to have a reconciliation and become intimate friends and tremendous respect and love for each other is a Christian miracle. It's hard to imagine that happening anywhere else. Perhaps more than anything else, it's an awareness of history that makes the Polish mind what it is. And it makes it so open, I think, to the biblical tradition, in which the God of creation yet speaks more powerfully in the events of human life. History is distinct from nature. You think of nature, you think of Scandinavia or different the fjords and forests, Germany with its lovely towns, Italy with its beautiful cities. When you think of Poland, I think it's primarily history, because the boundaries haven't been there in a long time. And you know, that history has been so difficult that Norman Davies titled one of his books God's Playground, you know, because kind of there's a theological theme interwoven throughout that history. That also suggests to me why personalism should emerge so strongly in Poland, where the human face generally stands out against a fairly flat, non-dramatic landscape, however charming. It's not like a Chinese landscape where you have a small figure and huge, beautiful mountains. It's the human face that stands out against a plain. It just speaks of the personalism which developed there. Now, Wojtyła was a great lover of mountains, and the Poles love mountains the way the Russians love the ocean. They don't have much of it, you know, and so they kind of love it. I had a section here which I'm going to skip. It's on the Slavs, much controversy as to what it is to be a Slav and so on. There's certainly Polish language is Slavic. It's part of the Slavic family of languages. But it's a bit, like someone pointed out to me, like saying, well, the Bretons and the Welsh and the Irish are all Celts, but they all have very different expressions of their lives. And my critic was saying, well, the Russians are Slavs, but they belong to Asia, and the Poles are Slavs, but they're Europeans. And there's something to that. So I will spare you my Slavophilia, which has been considerable. But this notion of the Slavic soul, which drives some people nuts, I think there's something to it. And Robinson Jeffers, do you know the poem to Robinson Jeffers? Czesław Miłosz has a brilliant poem on that, in which he contrasts his own Polish-Lithuanian roots with Robinson Jeffers' Celtic sensibility. But basically, he underlines the personalism that was there, the personification that was present in religion. Well, in its own conversion, you see in Slavophilia, the 19th century Slavophile movements in Russia and the Czechs, Congress in Prague, they actually excluded the Poles because the Poles were far too Western. Poles didn't like the Russians, there's no secret in that. They weren't really part of the Slavic thing. They were great Francophiles. They were Roman Catholic to the core. You know that Krakow is the largest Renaissance city north of the Alps, you know. And so it was just a different world from this kind of Slavic world that was described, you know, and one of the Russian Slavophiles described a Russian Slavophile went out on the street and they said he was so Slavic people thought he was Persian, you know. So that emphasis on the East, which really wasn't part of the Polish heritage. Converted in the 10th century, the Polish leadership were careful to stick close to Rome rather than place the church under the tutelage of the German hierarchy and submitting to the German emperor and their cultural realm, which of course was hugely powerful. The Polish king placed Poland and the church under Rome. They were little influenced by Byzantium, much by Rome, later by Renaissance Italy and Napoleonic France. Rubbing shoulders with the powerful Germans for 1,000 years, eating sauerkraut but preparing it very differently, resisting Germanization, they constantly looked over their heads to potential allies beyond, France and more recently Britain. This Roman orientation would have profound consequences later on, and it has to this day. Whereas we read that the church in Western Europe is largely moribund, the church in Poland has continued very much alive, if these days much beleaguered. First of all, the church in Poland, I think this is really important, was unique in that it was not primarily monastic. At one point, I was heading off to a hermitage, and I think that was my Russian blood leading me there, because I don't know if you know, some of you may know Professor Kamil Jovanovsky, of happy memory at Marquette, but his wife said to me, "Poles don't become hermits, you know, we're much too sociable." Anyway, they didn't have a strong monastic tradition. It was Franciscan and later Jesuit Catholicism rather than Benedictinism molded the national character. When you think of it, virtually all the national churches in Europe are profoundly rooted in monastic life, and that includes Russia. But Poland may be a lone exception of the larger churches. At the time of its conversion, Benedictinism was identified with German culture, both in the Czech lands and in Poland. St. Adalbert isn't Adalbert at all. It's Wojtek or Wojciech in Polish. So you had a German name and a Slavic name. What finally happened was that the Dominicans and the Franciscans really took off. If you want to see a really hot house of Dominican life, go to Krakow. It's the hottest hot spot in the church today for the Dominican life. And St. Dominic sent Jacek or Hyacinth to Krakow. His remains are there to this day. And then, of course, Poland eventually became perhaps the most Jesuit country in the world, which I'm rather proud of, but a lot of kind of Enlightenment Polish scholars do blame the Jesuits for all the woes of Poland. No, a lot of people do, and it's kind of flattering. I don't know if we were that powerful. So the church from its start was a popular church, and it was steeped in popular devotions. It was a church of the laity. It's not to say that there are not great gaps between the lordly hierarchy and the laity to this day, frankly, which Polish Catholics often bemoan. But still, it was a very lay, family-oriented church in a way that isn't quite true, I think, in other places. The hired clergy, of course, well, they were associated with the aristocracy. In both Polish and Czech, the word for priest is the same word as prince. So that gives you some idea where that's coming from. Excuse me. By the 18th century, the Polish state was under fatal attack from its neighbors. The internal weaknesses were excoriated by Jesuit court preacher Piotr Skarga. Anyway, then came the partitions. Poland did not know religious persecutions. You look at the wars of religion which tore Europe apart, massive, massive slaughter of people. It is true there's something, and human life is always precious, but you know, compared to tens of thousands of people killed in religious wars in Western Europe, I think there were 12, sadly, Lutherans killed in northern Poland in one attack towards the end of this whole period. There's not a remote comparison. As a matter of fact, the Polish church was constantly under attack from the German church. It's in the Council of Basel for being indifferentist, for not persecuting later on Protestants enough. They just weren't into it. The king of Poland said, "I'm king of my subjects, but not of their consciences." And he would not enforce the religious rules that were being done in Western Europe. Similarly, with the Jewish community, the reason why you had such a huge Jewish community is because the Jewish people were being expelled and burned alive in the rest of Western Europe, and they were welcomed by Casimir the Great in the 14th century to Poland. Poland was a republic of nobles, right? Like 7% of the nation were nobles, and they ran the country. So it was an unusually large aristocracy. The Szlachta is the word for an aristocrat, Schlachtschitz, which again, typical, the word Schlach, what does that come from? Probably Schlag, as in Schlachtzahne, the cream, the crema, Schlachta. They set the tone for Polish behavior to this day. You're either, Szlachetski or you're a ham, which is like ham in the Bible, which is like somebody who's base. But that would spell the doom in the 18th century, as I say, as the other states around committed themselves to royal absolutism. The aristocracy held on to its privileges. During the Reformation, the Jesuits, as I say, were very, very powerful. Unlike any of her large neighbors, Poland did not become Protestant, though there was a point at which most of the aristocracy, at least in the eastern, in Lithuania, did become Calvinist. The Jesuits showed up with the best education around, and they sent their kids to Jesuit schools, and the kids reconverted their parents, and that part then reverted to Catholicism. Also of note, Poland never had a national church the way France or Britain did. It was the church of the nation, but there were a number of nations living in this state. The dominant nation, Polish-speaking, were Roman Catholics, but there were other nations there as well who were part of the Commonwealth. As I say, subsequently, it was the only large Catholic nation left in Northern Europe, and some scholars have seen that as what provoked the other nations of Northern Europe to gradually squeeze them out of existence. It became a kind of a living museum, kind of this dinosaur of ancient Catholicism in Northern Europe. Now, indulge my piety. In the 17th century, something unique happened. The King of Poland crowned Mary the Queen of Poland. I think that's worth noting. England has its queen, Elizabeth. The Queen of Poland is Mary. And every year, if you go to Częstochowa, you can repeat your vows as a Polish Catholic to Our Lady, the Queen of Poland. I think that has to be mentioned. Many people might not be comfortable with that, but that's and also speaking of Poland, that happened in Lwów, which was a great Polish city in the Ukrainian countryside, which today is Lviv in western Ukraine. But at the time, it was obviously Polish enough that Our Lady was crowned Queen of Poland there. That gives you some idea where these things happened. And that consecration in 1656 happened on the eve of the Troubles, the great kind of century of invasions, uprisings that led to the partition of Poland, which had ended up as a powerless, stateless, humiliated nation, permanently excluded from the councils of this world. So that's kind of where we come up to the 19th century. Anchored in her Catholicism, a living experiment in republicanism, resistance to absolute monarchy, it was slated for destruction. The culture kept most alive in the province of Galicia, which was the Austrian province. The Austrians were the least intent on, they weren't intent on destroying the Poles, Polish Catholicism, unlike the Prussians or the Russians. And that's where Wojtyła was born and nurtured, right? His father was a retired Austrian army officer who had, however, I gather, I don't have this on the best of authority, but I did read it in print, that his father was involved in smuggling guns from the Austrian army as an Austrian officer to help the Polish underground before the First World War. Okay. People have often faulted John Paul, one of his criticisms, that he wasn't a better administrator. But the Poles had centuries of dealing with administrations of Prussians, and they had no interest in, and they couldn't become administrators, actually, in either Prussia or Russia without becoming either Lutheran or an Orthodox, you know. And so they were kind of excluded from power. Well, how did the hand of God lead this Catholic people to produce this leader of the church? And how did Poland emerge as the last remaining bastion, if you will, of Catholicism in Europe? This thick tangle of Polish religion and nationalism. In both Lutheran Germany and Orthodox Russia, the church was tamed and became a department of the state, basically. That didn't happen in Poland. I think this consecration of Mary is very, very much to the point. Also, Poland came to see in the 19th century the sorrows, the sufferings, in terms of the sufferings of Jesus himself. There's this kind of Polish, what's called Polish messianism, emerged. But kind of this, well, devotion to Poland, and Poland was often called the Christ of the nations. There's plenty of joy in Poland, but it's not a lighthearted spiritual culture. It's known more than its share of conquest, exile, betrayals, and so on. Also, after those partitions, 120-some-odd years, each of the three partitions left strong imprints on Poland, which if you're at all sensitive, you can see to this day. I could just see the seams of the country. I can see, you can just crystal clear what was built by the Prussians, what was more or less built by the Russians, and you can see the Baroque all over Galicia. It's just crystal clear. And as you come to know Poles, if you meet someone from Poznań, they have a very different character from someone from Kraków. If you meet someone from Gdańsk, you know that they're from Vilno, you know. that the different characters show up in those different places, and the population shifts, which are huge, which reflects itself in contemporary Polish politics. Again, the country was shifted 150 miles west. Millions of Germans were expelled. More millions of Poles moved from the east. Those who moved from the east moved into those German lands, and they were cut off from their cultural ties. Those are the parts of Poland today which are the most, if you will, open to the aggressive secularization of the West. The parts that remained rooted, the south, more or less eastern parts, are the parts which have remained most profoundly Catholic, just because you keep your religious traditions going in the place where you've always lived, without that profound dislocation that people have had. Bringing us to the 20th century, the reforms of Vatican II were implemented very carefully, by the way, with a strong, strong emphasis on lay formation. It's a puzzle to me. Many things about the Polish I don't understand, and one of them is, even though the Polish aristocracy loved Russian, loved Polish, Latin, they were writing Latin poetry, great Latin poetry, on these estates in the Ukraine and so on. Latin was present to the people, but boy, they wanted Polish in church. And so there was not a great, great resistance, I think, to the introduction of Polish. In fact, it really took off, you know, unlike so much of our country. Okay. John Paul. Well, his character. First of all, he's very Polish, but remember, he's from the Austrian part of Poland, extreme historical southwest Poland. Okay, his experience is not that of Vilna or Lviv or of Prussian Poles or something like that. So his whole character. His world, and I say this, okay, I'm not Chicagowski, but when Americans think of Poles, they think of beer and polkas. That's not my people, you know, we're looking at vodka and mazurkas, you know, completely different spirit, you know. But in southern Poland, well, I mean, it's part of the Austrian Empire, and it's beer and polkas, you know, like the Czechs, and that's the late 19th century, and that's what comes to Chicago, and that's what Polish do. And Wojtyła had that kind of character and that temperament. He's not a vodka-chugging person from Warsaw. It's more the kind of beer-drinking, hiking in the mountains type, and different. Very fatherly. He's been referred to as universal father. And I think, looking at it spiritually, one of the things that the seminarians so loved about him was his fatherly qualities, because it's a defeated fatherhood. It's not a kind of a fatherhood you would run into in the imperial powers of the neighbors. It was a different kind of a fatherhood. And I think that was essential to who he was and how he was. Again, he came from a country that had been colonized. And so when he goes to Mexico, they just know. They know. They can relate to him. And they build this huge statue of him right there in Guadalupe, you know, the shrine. Goes to the Philippines. He has 7 million people. Well, what's our history with the Philippines, you know, type of a thing. Even the Poles in Europe became a nation of Gastarbeiters, basically. And he was Polish, even though he's living in the Vatican. I had mass with him one morning. I didn't have an often. I said one morning. And one morning I was blessed to have mass from, and I walked out after mass and I'm talking with the Pope in Polish, and the Polish guys are outside, you know, washing the windshields of the cars at the lights. You know, that's what the Polish are doing. So he had a different kind of a sympathy, different kind of a sensitivity to other people. But the question is that Polish, or is that also being in some sense profoundly Christian? Is Christianity really a religion of and for slaves? However you translate doulos, if you want to be nice or if you want to be more faithful to the tradition. Well, we're called to serve. So he's the Polish Pope, brother to peoples. He wasn't totally welcomed by reactionary forces in the world, but he certainly was seen as a threat by the communists. His model of leadership then was a servant model, and he writes about that and speaks about that. But he refused to let the church resume a business-as-usual model among circles that wanted to do that. Another thing, he was the flower of that first generation of the Polish nation's survival and return to statehood. I don't know how I can convey that to you. All of my grandparents would have said they were Polish, and they all were Catholics, más o menos. And so they had Opłatek, and you know they were Catholics. But their real religion, I realized this about 2 years ago, was Poland. That was really their church. And so when Poland was resurrected in 1918, three of them went back to Europe. 70% of Polish immigrants to this country returned, I once heard a lecturer say. 70%. That's high. the real religion was the Polish, whatever the Polish thing is. And by the way, see, this is the thing. I've asked myself, why did the Irish fight so long and so hard not to become English? Why did the Polish resist? It's very simple. You change your name. Słomski becomes Stroman, then Deutscher, you know, and you're okay. But why did they resist? You'd be just cast out. Well, part of it is just plain orneriness or stubbornness. Part of it, I suspect, now this is the Catholic in me, so pardon me, but that they had known something better. Even the Protestant English have a phrase, Merry Old England. It was merry, I submit, because they had the Catholic faith, but that's okay. Partisan. But there was a memory of what it is to be a Catholic that the Irish, when they looked at Cromwell, or the Polish, when they looked at these other people, said, we don't want to be like that. We have plenty of bad apples, but it's not. There's something systemically wrong in this thing coming here. We're not going to go there, no matter what the price. I propose that. I'm not sure I would die for that. But I think it's worth considering as a reason why people remained Catholic and fought for their faith. And so for 100 whatever years, 25 years, and we know this, many of us who are Polish know this, you know, my father in Brooklyn, to jest polski dom. He was born in Massachusetts. But we speak Polish in this house. And also, I was once invited in the Soviet Union for what the Polish call spowiedź bez rozgrzeszenia, which is confession without absolution, with the KGB. And when I walked into this chamber where the people looked like FBI agents, and the Holy Spirit came to me, and I got bold, and I just said, I'm an American citizen, I want to see someone from the American embassy. The Gavrici Paruski. I said, I want to speak to an American. And one of them, one of these KGB people, said, Al pan po polsku rozmawia. I said, tak. Yes, you speak Polish. And he said to me, a son. I said, no, pochodzę z polskiego domu. I said, I come from a Polish home. And I looked at him and I said, a skąd pan pochodzi? Meaning, are you from a Polish family? Well, he was embarrassed, of course, ashamed. He's working for the Russians. He speaks Polish. So the interview went very nicely. They invited me back to Moscow. And they knew what I'd been doing 15 years before earlier, by the way. Don't mess with the KGB. Okay. So this whole Polishness, this cult of Polishness, what is it to be Polish? I remember hearing as a child, Polak grosza w kieszeni może nie mieć, ale honoru ma. You may not have any money, but you have your honor. You keep your honor. How do we comport ourselves? Well, that's what poor people do. So at the core of Wojtyła, Polish piety, strong Catholic philosophical and theological culture, contemplative spirituality. Now, I'd like to get into, I know our time is moving here, but there's something here more philosophical, more theological, which I think is important. And I'd like to read something from, actually, a Jesuit brother of mine, which I think is very helpful. When I mentioned the Polish hermeneutic, he said, hermeneutic means not only interpreting, but also, more importantly, seeing. Seeing the world, but also seeing the revelation of God, or seeing that in the world. German thought, as much as I relate to it, was derailed in this regard after Kant, maybe Lessing, and no longer believed what it saw. Once this seeing was gone, idealism was the logical consequence, thought and thought alone, all the way in our day to Rahner, in an idealistic approach to the faith, which once it is divorced from the vigorous philosophical efforts which these earlier thinkers were making, and is entrapped in the world of egalitarianism, comes down to systems, programs, and so on, rather than any contact with being, loving, relation, the person. The idealistic movement in philosophy left that. Even the German romantics, in a way, despite their turn toward nature, could not overcome this. It was still too much of an inward turn. Okay. So my younger brother says Poland never went that way. And part of it is the feminine dimension of Polish culture, which is huge, which in its archetypal type form is Marian. Okay. So another writer, this is scholar, Eva Thompson, whom you may know. The distinguished feature of Polish literature throughout the centuries is that it is almost invariably Thomistic. This is from a Jesuit. Okay. Thomistic, contemporary Jesuit. And what's the key to the Polish thing is tradition. Is tradition. Why Thomism? Nihil est in mente quod non erat prius in sensu. There's nothing in the mind that wasn't first in the sense. Eva Thompson would maintain that what kept the Poles from the madness of Nazi Germany or Soviet Russia was Aristotelian Thomism, and that is the insistence on sense-based knowledge and keeping you in touch with this world and not moving off into some idealistic never-never land, either individually or by mass. Okay? It's a sense-based, living, vibrant Catholicism, which is very, very open to poetry. I'm not about to read you Polish philosophers. They exist. They're very good. I would, if I had time, read you Miłosz. It's poetry. And poetry is what? Engaged. The senses are engaged. It's a different way of a perception. Father Mieczysław Krompiec, I don't know if you know Mieczysław Krompiec, famous Polish professor at Lublin. He worked with Wojtyła for years. He's characterized the Polish character as reasonable emotion. Now, I know my family too well to put a question mark next to the reasonable. But reasonable emotion, I think, speaks to it. Because I think you can get into the Slavic soul where it just becomes emotions. But the Poles are remarkably reasonable. They've been called the French who live on the Vistula. That may be an extreme. But soyez raisonnable is there as well. But it's with a profoundly emotional character. So Miłosz, the poet, insists the poetry art give form to the chaos of the emotional world, and John Paul was a man, of course, of deep emotion. Again, there's a sense of identification with victims of injustice, which comes out from that history, but also a strong insistence on an objective moral order, which drove a lot of Americans kind of nuts. When he showed up and said, what's right and wrong is kind of clear, and people hear, how can that be? So a story from my when I became a Jesuit in 1977, my mother, who was in a concentration camp, took me for coffee in New York, and she sat me down, as a mother can. She was a character. She was not above saying, listen, Buster, and it was one of those moments. She said of herself, she said, I was survived, you know, Stalin's Russia, and I lived in a German concentration camp. And she said, your life coming up in the 1960s in America was worse. She said, because your generation forgot the difference between right and wrong. And in the concentration camps, we knew what was right and what was wrong and who was a Schwein. You knew that. She said, your generation has lost that difference. It's far worse. Anyway, that's what Mom said, so I pass it on. But I think it's been pointed out to me that Wojtyła had that very, very strong sense of right and wrong, and that's deeply embedded in the Polish character. I propose that because many people that know it have said to me. Now, granted, I mean, I'm not saying these are a nation of saints, but it's a nation that goes to confession. That I think you can clearly say. Excuse me. Czesław Miłosz wrote that the future of Western civilization would be in the countries around Poland, even as life at the end of the Roman Empire had been in the Balkans. Less grand, but a true continuation of the tradition, so it seems to be. At least the struggle has been concentrated there. Wojtyła, a mystic. Someone has characterized him as, above all, what made him was that he was a mystic. You know, one of two doctoral dissertations was on John of the Cross. And many people experienced this. Again, not boasting, I lived in Rome for years and I spoke Polish, but I did get into Mass with him, and he'd have people at Mass with him. But after he said Mass, he would groan, like St. Paul says, you know, the Spirit groans within us. But he would groan. It was embarrassing, actually. It looked like Aslan the lion. I know I'm being romantic, but he did look like Aslan the lion, kind of there, just kind of groaning in his prayer. Well, to begin to move towards a conclusion, approaching the faith of Catholic Europe, you think of cathedrals, glories of the Middle Ages, and so on, but all of that's yielded to secularization. And Rome keeps blowing on ashes, hoping for sparks to happen. In Poland, a simpler version of the same heritage was largely obliterated and left in sheer ruins. The dark side of the modernization of Europe fell to the east, and as T.S. Eliot, you know, said, it fell into chaos. But out of those ruins came a vibrant faith in full communion with the ancient faith common to the continent, but daring to be new. You know, I had a dear, dear professor friend who was actually an alumnus of this school, and I will not mention his name. But he's an Anglo-Saxon Methodist, and he's very into mysticism, so he got into Sufism and Russian Orthodoxy, and he said he wanted to approach the religion of his ancestors. Well, as an Anglo-Saxon, that would have been Catholicism, it seems to me, you know. So the ancient heritage of Europe was present there and living in him. The saints have no resentment, and he was an image of that, I think, of a faith based on forgiveness, on mercy, not justice. And no acceptance of secular utopianism any more than of the collectivist utopianism of the Marxists. Towards the end of his life, as you probably know, he went to Poland and wept. It was a bit like Moses, who led the people out of the desert, and they found a golden calf. And you go to Krakow, and the churches are not as full, and the vast new malls are full, you know. So something else has moved in. A note on Polish America, if you'll indulge me. The Poles built great churches, as you know. They said in Milwaukee, where I lived for many years, the Germans built factories, the Poles built the churches. And you see that throughout all the lake cities, these magnificent churches that the Polish built. But they've had trouble from the start with assimilating. The only major schism in American history, church history, was the Polish National Church, as you know. They were excluded from church governance. Certainly ethnic monsignors and so on, but not really allowed into power. And if I may be indulged in a bit of rancor, I mean, I, as a Polish American, come to a city with, I think, 2 million Poles, and never has had a Polish ordinary in the church, never has had a Polish mayor or governor in Illinois. That is noteworthy, I think. I just think it's worthy of note and wondering what that's all about. Maybe they shouldn't be or don't want to be, but still it's worthy of note. Another thing that the Polish have a tremendous heritage of things like Christmas carols, just tremendous. Every bit as good as England, but you can go through American church hymnals and you will not find these things. So it's remarkable how so much of that has been lost. And as you know, there were these campaigns of vilification against Poles, historically the Polak jokes and so on. Part of it is I think the Polish experience was different and they came differently. They, unlike, say, the Irish who came here to stay, very, very large numbers, the Poles didn't intend to stay. They came from a very, very different culture. It was very difficult to convert their mentality. And as the Polish immigrants always said to me, the older people, they just said, well, we didn't have the language. It takes a generation to learn the language. And more than the language, the mentality, the very mentality. You know, when at least the people I'm from Eastern Poland, they never liked the people from Western Poland because if you go to one of their restaurants, they actually charge you for your food. That's so German. You know, different mentality. Okay. And so the Polish experience has been quite different. Okay. But that perhaps enough said there. In the end, there really is no chosen people, right, in the Catholic understanding, but the one people of God. What is it to share in that life of the people of God? Well, probably age varies from age to age. John Paul certainly brought that to light, and he was honored by people of other traditions for it. They saw it in him. Last week, the Wall Street Journal and quoted a famous Jewish conductor saying John Paul was a great rabbi. It's a beautiful thing, you know, to see the something of God that transcends particular histories. Okay. Well, again, I think that the great difference, great gift is this sense of right and wrong. What can we learn as Americans from this? I think we can learn truth, how to speak the truth. As a spiritual director of a seminary, I developed a theory that I call verotherapy. I think what we do in America, we try to, I'm sorry, this is sheer editorializing, it's irresponsible, I know that. But as a caricature, I know that. But when we see somebody who's not fitting in, we drug them up till they fit in. We don't ask, is this person freaking out because they're surrounded by a world of lies? Are we living the truth that deeply and that beautifully that we're eliciting goodness here? Or are we just accommodating ourselves to the lies of the advertising industry, the government, whatever, the universities? And therefore we drug ourselves up to be happy. And so it seems to me if you've ever had that experience of actually telling someone the truth, in love, by the way, you can tell the truth in a way that destroys somebody, but speak the truth, people come alive. It's like water in a dying plant. you know, when you begin breaking through boundaries. I think that's speaking the truth. I remember, again, my mother from that part of the world saying, what are you Americans so afraid of? Americans are so afraid. Well, of course, to live in a democracy, you have to internally police yourself. You don't just say everything's got to come in the mouth, the way my aunts in the Soviet Union, who, you know, they dealt with the Soviet governments, they could tell them whatever they think. Send me to Siberia. What do I care? You've already taken everything I own. You know, we have stuff that we worry about. Okay. Certainly we've learned things like Maximilian Kolbe, Faustina Kowalska, some of those saints from Poland who tended to be very humble people, I think have taught us a lot. More deeply, Poland is a country of heart. First time I went to Poland, this old grandmother came to the train and she said, bless your grandparents for leaving here because this country is soaked with blood. But it's a land of blood, but land of heart, the sacred heart in Catholicism. It's a land of heart. And Ray Adams, who's also known as Radek Adamczewski in Wyoming, has said to me that if you're going to be Polish, you have to accept the cross. You can deny it, you can change your name, you can take on another culture. People do that all over the place. In Milwaukee, I always said, what happened to the Polish who built these churches? Well, I said they changed their names and moved to Phoenix. That's what happened to most of them, in Buffalo or wherever. But if you accept the cross of Polishness, well, then that's what it is all about. And in the world of the high tech, I was just speaking with a wonderful young cleric in San Francisco, talking about the Silicon Valley and the absolute destruction, not of any faith in God, but of any faith in humanity. What's needed is a textured reality, with humanity. And this is what he brought us, that smile, that genuineness, that heart. Heart is what we need, it seems to me. And that, again, he offered. But the heart is not just romance, Chopin, if you will, who was a Catholic too, but Mary, the Queen of Poland, and the wounds through which Christ's life comes to us. I will leave the last word to Czesław Miłosz, okay, if I may. This is the ode for the 80th birthday of Pope John Paul II. We come to you, men of weak faith, so that you might fortify us with the example of your life and liberate us from anxiety about tomorrow and next year. Your 20th century was made famous by the names of powerful tyrants and by the annihilation of their rapacious states. You knew it must happen. You taught hope, for only Christ is the Lord and Master of history. Foreigners could not guess from whence came the hidden strength of a novice from Wadowice, the prayers and prophecies of poets, whom money and progress scorned, even though they were the equals of kings, waited for you, so that you, not they, could announce urbi et orbi, that the centuries are not absurd, but a vast order. Shepherd, given us when the gods depart. In the fog above the cities, the golden calf shines. The defenseless crowds race to offer the sacrifice of their own children to the bloody screens of Moloch. In the air, fear, a lament without words, since the desire for faith is not the same as faith. Then suddenly, like the clear sound of the bell from Matins, your sign of descent, which is like a miracle, people asking, not comprehending how it's possible that the young of the unbelieving countries gather in public squares, shoulder to shoulder, waiting for news from 2,000 years ago, and throw themselves at the feet of the vicar who embraced with his love the whole human tribe. You are with us and will be with us henceforth when the forces of chaos raise their voice and the owners of truth lock themselves in churches and only the doubters remain faithful. Your portrait in our homes every day reminds us how much one man can accomplish and how sainthood works. That's that. Thank you.